Okay, stand by, pushing the live button.
Okay.
The live button is pushed. My experience so far is that has worked pretty fast, so I'll bring in the whoosh. Now, technically, this is the Dayton pop-up number 4, but we haven't heard from the guys.
Yeah, and neither we're not at Dayton either, so.
Yes.
But Marty's there. Jason's there.
Yep.
And
so maybe they will come on, but you have joined me in as a break from your working day.
Yeah, which I'll get back to in a little while, but yep.
Okay, hang on. I'm being warned about something. Let's see what I'm being warned about.
Uh-oh.
Timeout publishing the stream. Verify the stream name and if you have provided any credentials or tokens. I have no idea.
Which stream? Facebook?
Well, I'm sending two streams.
Well, so it said in the little text there, I think it said Facebook.
Oh. Okay. Well,
let me check.
I'm recording. I'll pump it up to whatever we're
okay.
Whatever is missing when
right when it's all done.
Yeah, when it's done. So while we were waiting for these guys, we were talking about what you're doing for field day, and it was pretty interesting. So I've got a Google map up here of the field day site that you guys are going to be at. Let me get wide and see and get our orientation. So there's the where did Los Angeles go?
It's all there. It's all Los Angeles. I don't know if you didn't zoom out too far.
Yeah, I had it upside down.
That's Santa Monica Mountain. So Los Angeles is kind of, so there, where you see the red thing, that's kind of the middle. Yeah. Yeah, the city of Los Angeles is kind of down there, and then above it is the San Fernando Valley.
Okay.
And I think every year they talk about breaking us off and making us our own city, but for the time being, it's all, what you see there is mostly all Los Angeles.
Yeah, that's probably just talk. Never going to happen.
Yeah, well, taxes and yes, probably not.
Okay, so there's where's the Hollywood sign? Is that way up?
Probably
here
about where? No. Probably about where your mouse was. A little bit more to the right, and then down. Keep going.
Okay, there it is.
Hollywood sign. There you go.
All right.
And so then you're there's the Hollywood Bowl would be to the left of that.
Yeah.
Along the pass there, kind of at the bottom.
And so your field day site is here at this what's called the Nike Missile Control Site. LA 96. Do they still launch missiles from there?
Okay, so it's a very widely misunderstood setup, the Nike missile tracking stuff. LA 96 never actually had any missiles there. It was solely a tracking station. There was radar and other technology stuff. The actual Nike missiles were on the floor of the San Fernando Valley at like Woodman and Victory. And in fact, there's a different site. I'll get you the number. We'll talk about it as we get to the field day episode. And you can go back and see historically where they had the missiles there, including apparently nuclear tipped ones, like just right in the middle of the city. And if you go look at the Google map of that site now today, you can still see the kind of the concrete bunkers where they had all those things. But what was up there was all telemetry tracking, kind of watchtower stuff. Cause from up there, you can kind of see, you know, from horizon to horizon, mountains in the way, you know, like the Mount Wilson, 6,000 feet to the east. You can't see over that, but otherwise you get a pretty good view of everything from up there.
Okay. Yeah, we can, using the Google 3D, we can kind of look around and...
Yeah, you can kind of see all around there. So it's a great ocean view. We do tend to get, you know, because it's in June, we get, you know, June gloom. So in the morning, sometimes we get a marine layer that'll roll in there. Otherwise it's a great spot. There's some electrical lines on the road there at the bottom, but we're high kind of higher above it, and we have a good time.
I've lost. Okay, there's, that would be the ocean view.
Yeah, that's the Pacific Ocean there.
Yeah, from the Google 3D it doesn't look like you see the ocean very well, but
you can see it well. So on the tower, when you're at the top of the tower, the second, the higher of the two red markers there, there's like the big metal tower. If you zoom in, that's where all the tracking stuff was.
Okay. So all this stuff is still there. Everything that's showing up.
Yeah. Yeah. That's probably recent pictures and stuff. So that's still there. There's a lot of public services. There's an antenna tower there above that green marker. That's a lot of public service, police, fire, public works, radio stuff up there.
Okay.
We have to promise not to interfere with any of that.
Okay. So it's an active site.
Yes.
There's power and stuff still run up there. Do you have bathrooms or anything?
To the left of the red dot, there's a square building a little further down. Yeah, right there. That's a bathroom facility. Oh, there you go. Now you're on the ground. You could do a walk around tour probably. Yeah, that's a hot and cold running water.
Okay, so it's like a park.
Yeah. Yeah, this is part of the Santa Monica Mountains Conservancy. So it's a good site when we open up the gates in the morning, because it's only open sun up to sundown to the general public. But we get a lot of foot traffic. People come out there and take a look at what we're doing.
So it qualifies as a public site.
Yeah. Yeah.
So you get bogus points.
Yeah. We do. We try to have a public service table out there and give out flyers, try to recruit people to join us. We'll typically have served agency, because we do serve that group that manages the facilities up there. They'll come and visit. Sometimes we'll get a council person or other law enforcement or fire to come up and join us.
Okay, Google got their camera all over the place here. There's that tower you're talking about.
Yep.
And let's see, you...
That's the tower. So the tower there, that's the one we'll climb up, and then we'll have stuff kind of all around where you are, so both directions.
You can climb up on that.
Yep, absolutely. In fact, we'll set up an easy up on the top of that and a table, and we'll string off a mast to the tower there. And we get a lot of annoyed people on 2 meters and 70 centimeters asking us to turn off the kilowatt amplifier.
Which you're not running.
Which we're not running.
So you do a VHF, UHF.
Yeah, that's what we'll put the VHF, UHF station up there. So we usually run 2 or 3 alpha, so we get the free UHF, VHF.
You've got
station.
All of this and you just 2 or 3 alpha?
Yeah, because we only end up having maybe a dozen or 18 people, and not a lot of them will spend the night. But if you want to come out and join us, we'll get you operating.
I'm tempted.
But and maybe 2023 we'll plan ahead a little bit more.
Yeah. Okay. So so you set up across this whole thing. You were saying you set up some stuff.
Yeah, down below where you are, there's like a picnic table and kind of a flat. Yeah, right there. There's a picnic table and kind of a flat area.
Okay. Google Maps doesn't get me there. So.
Yeah, and then there's the stripes you see or you saw up kind of more near the service tower stuff. We'll put an RV or something up there, or maybe two, depending on who brings what. And then we have fun. And we're not super competitive, although I know there's guys on the team that will tell me, yes, we are.
Did I lose it? I'm still on
my... Yeah, no, you're right there.
Okay.
You're right there.
Oh, yeah. Yep. Okay. I see. And there's... It looks like... I mean, the Google Maps is not great for fine detail when you're close up, but it looks like there's trees. Okay, I can...
Yeah, there's not a ton. There's not a ton of trees.
Little scrubby trees.
Yeah, little scrubby trees. You know, mostly then that path where you're at there is we'll run coax and whatever out there and put up the military mast towers, and the trees end up being the guys for the dipoles and stuff like that.
Okay.
Mostly inverted bees. We'll put maybe one straight up across two towers.
You're up high enough that it's like, who cares?
Yeah. Yeah.
What's that in there?
So there's an underground vault there, which is where all the technology for the public service, all the stuff that feeds the
okay, so they got a bunker under there for the radios.
Yeah, yeah. Not something I've had the privilege of seeing inside. I've seen some pictures. But yeah, that's our site. And, you know, we do encourage
folks. I guess you could string dipoles and stuff from this, this big tower?
We haven't. We've talked about it, but for the most part,
it's the high spot.
Yeah. For the most part, the site still stays open to the public. We don't close it down. So we have to be a little careful about how many hazards we put up. We may string caution tape on the other side where that path is out to the end where we put up the towers.
Yeah. What I can see is a dipole from there. And you'd run, you know, some cord so that you don't have a hot RF. Yeah. For a few feet, and then you climb up this tower and you put it on.
Oh no, we can't get to that tower. Yeah, I'd love that too. I think you're 100% right. Actually, the other way, there's a old abandoned telephone pole, and I've often thought if we could get a down the other way. Those are active, but behind where you are, right there, there's a telephone pole there. It looks taller than it is in the picture. Oh, I think you just passed it. To run something from that up, like off center.
Yeah, bring your lineman spikes.
Yeah, exactly. Somebody's got some of those. Ruzy has some. But yeah, that's our site. And you can see there, that's east. So you're looking out east. So yeah,
there's your picnic table.
Yeah, there's my picnic table.
So that's you put all the stations there.
No, actually we don't. We use that site a little bit less. Mostly everything ends up on that concrete pad where it's red there to the left, where that's where the RV is, and we just kind of run all the antennas out one way or the other, and because it's nice there, it's nice and flat. The rest of it's a little iffy.
And you can only get three stations going from up there.
No, we only have enough people to man three stations. I argue that we should do more. But there's always controversy around it. Last year, we actually did. I was able to talk them into doing three alpha. And when we got the results several months later, three alpha, we scored in the mid-teens as far as overall points. If we had gone to four alpha, we would have been second or third place in the overall points, just based on the numbers of people that had four alpha.
The higher you get, the less competition there is.
Exactly. So I made a strong argument to say, well, you know, next year we can do four alpha. We don't have to have four on the air all the time. It would be ideal. It'd be great. But again, because, you know, there's less teams in that area, we would have scored better and placed a little higher. And again, what do we say? Is it a contest? Not a contest.
It's a contest.
No, it's not a contest.
It's a camp out. It's an emergency exercise.
That's right.
And it's a contest.
Yeah.
Do you keep score?
We do.
Are there winners?
You know, I don't know.
Well,
they don't hand out. I mean, they definitely put out the who was the top whatever, but I don't think you even get a piece of paper certificate.
No, but there's winners. So
yeah.
It's the reason it gets people. You get a lot of people out for field day, and you don't get a lot of people out for the simulated emergency test.
Yeah.
Because field day is a contest.
That's right. And we will contest, and we'll do the best that we can with our contests, and we'll see where it goes.
Okay. So taking a look at the Dayton live streams right now, let me refresh the page and see if anybody's doing anything. No, just the three forum rooms are still all that's going. Let me turn off the live filter and just filter for today and see what we got. Yep, Ham Radio Outlet was doing some video. There's us. The Great Lakes Division welcomes you. Let's see what they're doing.
Hi, this is Bob the Traveler here. Hamvention.
Okay, there's a lot of those that happen.
Around the
Looks like there's a lot of presence there, a lot of people.
Yeah, it ought to be crowded. I mean, as crowded as that facility gets.
Yeah.
Great Lakes Division welcomes you.
Okay, well, that's exciting.
Flea market? Is that flea market? Hard to tell. It's not real crisp.
This one that's flying here, Julian Frost. Yeah. Let's see what Julian's doing.
YouTubers, shortwave listeners, ham radio operators, ladies and gentlemen, friends and followers, welcome to Dayton Hamvention. I'm just watching it.
Everybody,
live stream of...
Everybody's a broadcaster.
Well, we're all hams, right?
Yeah.
They're doing such a great job. But Josh did a live stream earlier from Ham Radio.
Well, they can't get our guys to get on the stream. We'll just use the other people.
Right.
They already visited the ICOM corner, and now they're working them their way up. You know.
All right.
They visited the.
What else we got? We got us a lot. The pre-convention exploring behind the scenes. Let's check that out a little bit.
Excuse me.
Good.
I was told I won the grand prize in advance. So
okay,
I'm
that's.
Pick it, up.
It says 2022, but that looks more like the Hera Arena.
You didn't win the grand prize.
They're shipping.
Oh, they're shipping it? Oh, thank you. I've
already told three of my buddies they gave me money.
I have no idea what they're talking about here.
Yeah.
I think we're picking up a, we're picking up Jim.
I left it up front.
What?
I'll see you guys tomorrow.
I have no idea.
Well, good morning, Mr. Aspinwall.
Good morning.
How's it going? Happy Friday. Or as my daughter would say, happy Fry-yay, except she wasn't really Fry-yay in this morning when I took her to school.
Well, it's the last day of my weekend, and it's back to work for 2 days.
Yeah.
So,
well, so far,
so far Dayton's a dud.
Although, you know, I don't know, the video that we saw of other people streaming look like it's a as a happening of an event as you could hope for. There were people there. They were milling around buying stuff, and who knows?
Yeah, I think that when Marty is telling us on text that there's not much going on, it's no fascinating new equipment. ICOM's got a new amplifier, and they've got a. They got a radio that is not going to be a million seller, but it's something that the microwave guys are going to be real happy to see. I expect a 5 gigahertz transceiver that is mast mounted, so you don't have to have coax that is this big running up your tower to avoid the loss. Put the radio unit, the RF unit, up on the tower and control stuff. They said it was power over Ethernet. So
that's an ICOM thing.
Yeah. And,
is that just their try to get into Arden and whatever.
That's what it sounds like. Yeah.
And is it going to be compatible technology? Wait, let me guess. The answer is probably not.
D-Star on 5 gigs.
It didn't say D-Star,
but
So I don't know. But there hasn't been big manufacturer support behind that stuff before. There's small microwave associates, I guess, and stuff make transmitters that'll get you up there. So why ICOM thinks that they want to build a radio to do that, I don't know, but they do. So cool. It was built. This is not out yet. It's not a product they're selling. It's and it was in the form factor of one of their HF small footprint HF radios, 7500 or something. Things I'm not at all familiar with because I'm out of touch.
Well, I'll be intrigued to see it. I will be disappointed if it's not compatible with all the other technology.
Yeah, I learned all this from Josh's stream on Ham Radio crash course, which I'm not seeing here. Don't know why. Anyway, when our guys decide to show up, we'll come back and do a show.
All right, some more show. I'll be here on and off most of the day.
Yeah. Oh, I guess did we talk online about Kenwood not being here?
I saw that post.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm not sure. Yeah. I think we were talking about that before we clicked the go live button. That Kenwood is not there, and they were not at the Orlando Hamcation either. So there's been speculation for a while about what Kenwood's going to do, but not showing up at the two big Hamfests this year says something. Mm-hmm. Plus their line of radios is shrinking.
Right, which makes me think either it's going away or they've got a lot of new stuff in the can that's coming soon, but not feeling it.
Yeah, if they had a lot of new stuff and they're not ready for Dayton, they're...
You know. Yeah. Well, next year.
Yeah.
I mean, it's been the time to do it. But you look at, you know, with the Chinese coming up with an HF radio and various other SDR options and so many different handhelds that are around. You know, I just wonder if they're not getting squeezed by not having development and, you know, looking at the market. I mean, Flex and ICOM on the high end, and Yaesu's taking the middle ground, you know, and then you got the Chinese coming in.
It was funny at Yuma, the manufacturer that was there that had the toys and a beautiful booth was just Flex. And that's some nice stuff. But there wasn't anybody else there, and it's, you know, Yuma's a small ham fest, but there weren't any of the other manufacturers, you know, that showed up or had anything going. Spam risk. And then there was HRO, and then all the like the second tier vendors, and as I said, there was a lot of Chinese HTs and mobiles, and I think one of the vendors had the Zygu, the HF radio that people are liking, but I don't know.
Well, you would think that the manufacturers, if I'm thinking a lot of this is what we're seeing, so many the hotspots, the DMR hotspots, All-Star, Pi-Star, mm-hmm. the D-Star stuff, that everybody's sensing that the market is going internet based and, you know, may not be wanting to risk the investment. And ICOM seems to be the only one putting any money into advocacy in the hobby with Ray and
yeah.
His outreach. But I would think the manufacturers would want to do more outreach and do more than just try to promote glossy products and QST, but look to the ham clubs and say, hey, what can we do to help you increase your membership? You know, where's the interest going? And do some outreach polling to say, how can we help increase our market share through advancing the hobby? And that's maybe amateur radio marketing people just don't get that, like consumer marketing does. But it's I see a lot on Facebook, you know, a lot of people are getting into restoring vintage Heath kits and, you know, looking at some of the old radios. And there are some people that are interested in getting out a soldering iron and a screwdriver and cutting wire. You know, as much as I see the activity going on in the internet based stuff. So how do we make this hobby? How do we promote this hobby? Where do we do that? And save everybody so we still got gear in 10 years.
been a question for a long, long time.
And I wonder as we see more stuff like Flex, if the gear in 10 years is even going to look like, you know, there's the whole move towards there's no knobs and no dials. Like, Jim, your radio doesn't have any knobs or dials, right? It's all...
It's got...
It's all mice and keyboard, right?
A push button.
But a few years ago, you know, the last Dayton I was at, Flex had come out with the front panel version of their radio.
Yeah, they had the people wanted the Maestro. Yeah, but I think I can see that, you know, integration, conflagration, I'm not really sure the word to use for it, but you know, 10 years, it's going to be a PC like what Jim has behind him, you know, mouse, keyboard, or you're going to do this in the air and control all of the stuff, like, you know, all a Minority Report.
There'll be a neural tap. You just have to think.
Yeah, there you go. You just sit back in your Parka lounger.
Well, maybe that's why I can get Kathy interested in HF. If we get her Oculus and the Metaverse hooked up, she can start DXing.
Tim, where did you put your mic? Is it in the next room somewhere?
Is he low? Oh, he's on the Yeti.
Yesterday I was too hot, and today I'm too cold.
You're also too far away.
Yeah. Well.
So
I can bring it closer.
Bring a little. That'll do both. Accomplish both tasks. One is bring you a little more present, and the other is make you a little louder.
Somebody showed a month or two ago, I saw, it may have been who's the guy that took over Ham Nation?
Josh.
Josh did I think it was Oculus or one of the other VR demonstrations of some kind of ham radio integration with SDRs and all that were kind of along the lines of that. Where, you know, you were in an immersive environment of, but you had a PC screen here and a PC screen there, and there was some other stuff in the background. I thought that was kind of interesting. I don't think very MCOM-ish, but I could see, you know, Verd DXing and some of the other rag two stuff.
Yeah,
it could be interesting to have, you know, a virtual DX experience in the metaverse and see yourself. Convey yourself as your signal going to Europe or some other place. reach out and go, and then you go point. Oh, well, I want to talk to Italy, and all of a sudden everything just says, "All right, your beam and all that other stuff's going to change direction based on where you're looking." You're going to have a pretty fast rotor.
I also think that remote is going to be more and more the important thing in ham radio, because we can't, more and more of us can't put up decent stations at home.
But where are you going to remote them to? This is going to be an interesting issue, whether you're going to, you know, rent station space or, spend, a couple thousand a year for some hilltop, which may not be the best place you want to do.
Your HF. I think they'll need to be shared. You know, there's a few enterprises out there doing station sharing now. There's a little bit expensive. If you only want a few hours a month, it's not too expensive.
So, but it makes it kind of hard to just jump on a whim.
Sorry, it's work stuff.
David's going back to work.
Yeah. I'm gonna drop off. If they come back and join, I got a couple things I got to do, but I can pop in and out.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, the idea was on the street in Dayton, and we got nobody on the street yet, so.
Yeah, they have,
they're having lunch.
Right. All right, guys. Well, I'll be here. Lunch. Send me a text.
Okay, I'll go find out what stream decided it wanted to fail. And
the Facebook didn't work, was what it looked like.
Facebook, okay, yeah.
Yeah.
In the meantime, I'll send the big boom coming by. Gary Pierce, K4AAQ.
David Goldenberg, W0DHG.
Jim Aspinwall, NL1PC.
Over.
All right. And?
Out.
See you guys.